Hello, good morning, good evening, depending upon which time zone you are in. So for next 20 minutes, I'll be talking about Postgres HA with PG Pool 2 and what's been happening in PG Pool 2 world lately. Originally, this talk was 45 minutes, but I only got 25 minutes slot for this session. So I'll have to fly through a few of the slides, so bear with me. Okay, so this is me. I'm Muhammad Usama, you can call me Muhammad. I'm a senior database architect with Hygo. Prior to that, I was associated with Enterprise DB. I'm kind of working in Postgres or related to Postgres for the last 12 years, and I'm also an active member and core committer of PG Pool 2 open source project. Okay, enough about me. Let's get on with the actual content. This is the agenda for the talk. Basically, the talk consists of two sections. First, I'll give a brief overview of database HA and ways to implement it using PG Pool 2. And in the second part, I'll go through some of the recent enhancements that have gone into PG Pool 2, and we'll talk about the future directions of the community. Okay, so database high availability. So let's start with what's the high availability. Well, if you look up the Wikipedia for HA definition, it states something like, high availability is a characteristic of a system which aims to ensure an aggregate level of operational performance, usually uptime for higher than normal period. So effectively implementing the database high availability means designing a database system in such a way that the system should be able to sustain almost all types of known failures. That includes database failure, physical hardware failures, and any kind of software failure. Another important aspect of database high availability design is to ensure there should not be a data loss in case of any component failure. Okay. So what is recipe? How to design a HA database system? Basically, there are three key principles of implementing the high availability. Number one is eliminate any single point of failure. And this is done by adding redundancy so that the failure of any one part of the system does not lead to the collapse of an entire system. The number two is detection of failures. The second thing we require is a health checking mechanism of the system to effectively detect any kind of component failures. The third strategy or principle is to implement a reliable crossover. Well, once we have a redundant system and a mechanism in place to detect the faults, next thing we require is to act upon the alarms generated by a failure detection system. So to implement this part of the strategy, we need a mechanism or a component that can reliably remove the failed component and shift the workload to a healthy one. I've also listed load balancing as the fourth principle for HA, but that is an optional one. Thing is, when we are adding a standby component, specifically a database system, why not put it to work while it is waiting for a primary one to fail? So it's good to have no idle components, but it's not a hard and fast requirement for HA. So load balance is good to have, but an optional component for HA. So let's now discuss how will we implement each part of the required strategy to build a high available Postgres cluster. The first thing we need to do is to create or eliminate SPOF or single point of failure for our main resource, that is Postgres server. And that is done by installing multiple replicated database servers. There are lots of third-party tools that can do online database replication like Celonis. PG Pool 2 also have a built-in replication mechanism, and Postgres also has its built-in replication mechanism as well. So we can create cold standbys, warm standbys, and hot standbys using built-in streaming replication that is provided by Postgres. But no matter which technology we use for creating the standby database, the requirement is to have a standby database. And PG Pool 2 can effectively work with almost all kind of existing replication solutions or replication technologies. But the go-to choice with PG Pool 2 is almost always built-in streaming replication and hot standby. So this is what we'll use for our reference. So once we have a redundant Postgres database server, the next piece of puzzle is to detect the failures. So the idea here is to continuously monitor the health of each component. As soon as a failure is detected, we should act upon the failure to make sure we don't get a service disruption. On face of it, this health checking seems like a simple job, but it is little more trickier than how it looks. An effective health check mechanism or health check system needs to ensure that it should filter out the false alarms and temporary glitches. And on top of it, it needs to ensure that the failure it is seeing is not its own failure. I mean, it's not a health checking system that itself is failing. And so we need to take care of this one. For example, if a database health checker does not ping to a server after every and does a ping to a server of every few seconds to check if the server is available or not, and the unsuccessful ping would mean a server failure. But at the same time, it could be because of the problem with the system that health check is installed on, or it could be a network issue between server and a health checking system only. So it is a responsibility of an effective health check system to identify and validate the problems, and it should be quick enough to do that. We don't want to waste a precious time here. Okay, after we have a redundant database system and an effective and efficient failure detection system installed, all that stands between us and a high available Postgres database system is a requirement of a system that can act on alarms for health checker and switch over to a healthy component should any component fails. For our Postgres HA system, the most valuable component is our database server. And the most critical scenario is when the primary database server fails. So we need a failover management system required to do four basic tasks. So the task, four basic tasks, they are listed here, a system that to promote a standby primary when a primary process fails, adjust a standby nodes to follow the new primary when the primary changes, and seamlessly retire failed standby nodes and allow new standby nodes to be added without disrupting the system. So how can we do that? So here we are, we have a standby Postgres server that can take over in case of primary server fails, but we need a health check system to detect problems, and we need an authentic failover system to make a switchover. So the answer for all these problems is pgpool2. So let's start with what is pgpool2. Well, pgpool2 is around for more than a decade now, and I'm sure most of you already have a good idea and heard about pgpool2 and what it does. So I'll try to quickly go through this slide, and I've listed down the main features and the components of pgpool2. So let's get on with to the next slide. Okay, so this is the basic idea of pgpool2. It is a middleware server that sits between client and database servers. So effectively, all client application connects to pgpool2, and it routes the client request to one or multiple Postgres server depending on the availability of the server or the type of the request. Like write request goes to primary only, and the read can be load balanced. Okay, so as we know, standby servers are read only in nature, and we always need to have a primary database server to serve the write load. So what happens when the primary database gets failed? Well, to be fair, that is a disastrous situation, and there is nothing much we can do other than to promote a standby server to become a new primary. So like all other HA system out there, pgpool2 also do exactly that and promote one of the available standby servers to the new primary. But since pgpool2 sits between the client and Postgres as shown in the picture, which of course has its own pros and cons. but this setup enables pgpool2 to make this primary server switching experience very smooth and almost unnoticeable to for the clients. As far as the clients are concerned, they just keep connecting to the same IP port and database even after primary server fails and the switchover happens. Only the in-flight transactions get aborted, and the client only feels very small and negligible glitches. So yeah, the picture is just depicts like the primary fails and one of the standby, the third one becomes a primary. Okay, similarly, failure of any of the standby server is smooth and not noticeable as well. When a standby server fails, BGBlutoo detects it and detaches it from itself. Administrator gets the notification, and well, he can take whatever action they wants to do. But the main thing is the server, the service, the database service remains uninterrupted. So is it enough? Do we have just making sure that a failed primary server gets replaced by promoting a standby to a new primary and seamlessly removing the failed standby from a cluster give us a high available database system? Is that what we are starving for? The answer sadly is no. What if BGBlutoo itself gets failed? So just by looking at this diagram, we can see that BGBlutoo is now the single point of failure in the system. Although we have taken care of database system failures, but failure of BGBlutoo would take down the whole database servers, and that's a disaster. So what's the solution? Watchdog. BGBlutoo Watchdog. So what is the watchdog? Well, it's a built-in HA component of BGBlutoo that is implemented as a sub-process of BGBlutoo and is responsible for making sure that client application must always have a single point of contact to the database service. And they always see a consistent view of database cluster, no matter what component gets failed or whatever happens. The slide lists some of the core tasks that watchdog process of BGBlutoo performs. It does the health checking of all BGBlutoo nodes within the cluster. That is different from the database Postgres database node health checking. That BGBlutoo does to monitor the health of database system. Basically, watchdog process of the BGBlutoo perform the health checking of other BGBlutoo nodes. It has nothing to do with the Postgres health checking. Other thing, it selects, it's the responsibility of Watchdog to selecting the best leader node among all the live nodes. And it also manages and controls the virtual IP address switching that is used for always keeping the single point of contact of database service for the client applications. Finally, the Watchdog also manages and performs the distributed failover to make sure that each BGBlutoo part of the cluster always has the consistent and the correct view of the database. Servers or our cluster. So this is how BGBlutoo looks like, cluster looks like after the addition of Watchdog. You can see instead of a single BGBlutoo node, we now have multiple BGBlutoo nodes all configured with the same database server. This is the first principle of providing a high availability. Like we must have all redundant systems. So now we have redundant BGBlutoo systems, and this configuration ensures that in case of BGBlutoo node failure, we have a standby BGBlutoo to switch to, and to keep the single point of contact for client application, we now use virtual IP address instead of a physical IP address. Okay, so this is. So here is when the active BGBlutoo fails, the standby BGBlutoo takes over the center stage and steals the virtual IP address from the failed BGBlutoo node, do the ARPing ritual and stuff like that. And eventually the client application just keep connecting to the same IP port pair without noticing any difference. So, so now with the backend failover and BGBlutoo watchdog, we have a high available Postgres database system. This is the recipe of for providing HA. So before concluding this section of HA, let me just list out the advantages of using BGBlutoo for building an HA. Well, as we know, there are lots of systems out there that can be used to configure high available Postgres cluster. So we can why should we use BGBlutoo? So one of the things that makes BGBlutoo stand out from the rest of the available system is its ability to utilize the standby nodes, as we discussed earlier. So like those standby nodes might be sitting idle with other HS system in hope to get their turn when something goes wrong with the primary database. In nutshell, seamless load balancing of PGpool 2 sets it apart from rest of HA providers. Other than that, few other good things about PGpool 2 are it makes the cluster appear as a single Postgres instance, so no special handling is required on application front. That means all standard Postgres clients work seamlessly with PGpool 2. And it has highly configurable and robust PG node health mechanism or health checking and automatic failover mechanism that are custom made for Postgres database servers. It gives the flexibility and control to select new primary node when the primary fails. And finally, it has its own built-in watchdog to solve its own SPOF. So this is one in all solution. You only need a PGpool 2 it will take care of every aspect of HA for Postgres database. All right, so this brings us to the next part, what's been happening in the PGpool 2 world and where is the community heading to? I think I've already consumed my allocated, quite of time. So I'll try to just quickly go over some of the major highlights and try to squeeze in the time. So basically the recent focus of PGpool 2 community revolves around four aspects: reliability, performance, high availability, and usability. So keeping these focus areas in mind, the recent version of PGpool 2 have added and improved quite a few modules of PGpool 2, like PCP, that is the management interface of PGpool 2. Used to be one command at a time interface, and now it can handle multiple concurrent commands. On top of that, we have added some new PCP utilities, and existing ones also got new options as well. Similarly, we have made lots of strides in terms of performance and memory utilization optimizations. Extended query handling was revamped in version 4.1, I guess, and that resulted in around 100% performance improvement in some cases. A new shared relation cache mechanism was introduced in PGpool 2 last year and also produced some good performance numbers. And when it comes to high availability functions, I think this is the area that has received the most upgrades and improvements. The watchdog, that is the core HA function of PGpool 2, was rewritten from scratch around a couple of years back. And now it uses all the modern distributed system algorithms to ensure quorum and build consensus to verify and detect faults, and uses very sophisticated mechanism to elect the best leader node. And also Postgres backend node failover system is also revamped, and it now builds consensus and ensures the quorum to make the whole process less error prone and more reliable. On top of that, we have enhanced failover mechanism to avoid distributed logs, and that paid dividends in terms of improved failover speed. Other than that, if you compare some 3 or 4 years older version of PGpool 2 with the latest one or with the current one, you'll immediately feel the improved reliability. We have spent lots of hours in fixing the reliability and memory utilization aspects of PGpool 2. And we have added exception and memory managers and squashed some lots of bugs that resulted in very robust and reliable PGpool 2. So the latest version of PGpool 2 is really very stable. And there were some complaints around the reliability and the memory management of PGpool 2 around a few years back, but you'll not see these anymore in the current versions. So next few slides talks about more details of enhancement that I have just given an overview of. So I'll just quickly skip through these. So no more split brains. Well, those of you who are familiar or have used the older version of PGpool 2 might have come across some split brain syndrome complaints. So the latest written watchdog in PGpool 2 has taken care of all these type of complaints. And Yeah, again, this is some internal improvement we have made to H a component of PGPL 2, and I think I've already covered. So let's skip that. Like we have implemented a voting mechanism, and this is another little usable feature we have added. The read-written watchdog gotten away from the using the binary communication, and now uses JSON data format and exposes an interface to hook external health checking systems. This is a very, very useful small feature to deploy PGPL 2 in cloud environments that already provides a health checking mechanism. For example, if your cloud provider already has a built-in health checking mechanism, so why not use that? So this comes also we have added PGPL 2 WD CLI utility. You can take a look at that just in case you are interested in to hook some external health check mechanism. It has handy functions. You just need to call those functions just and to integrate. You don't need to write your own JSON and stuff like that. So yeah, this is a good improvement we made. Well, this slide just lists some of more notable enhancements that have been added to recent versions. Most of these are self-explanatory, but one thing I do want to mention here is a new snapshot isolation mode. It's a really interesting new addition and can be used to build a multi-primary Postgres server with atomic visibility. I don't think there are many solutions out there for Postgres that provides atomic visibility with multi-primary Postgres setup. So do explore this. This is a very big topic, so I can't explain it any further. But do explore this if you are interested in scale-out solution for Postgres that also provides the atomic visibility. Okay, so yeah, the current version main focus was usability improvement, and I've listed few of the features that we have added towards that. And similarly, 4.3, this is the current in development version, and some of the things in the pipeline for this one are the Chinese documentation. We want to currently PGPL 2 provides Japanese and English and a part of French translation, but we are focusing on providing a Chinese documentation. Then we are also working on memory usage optimization, easy configuration administration, and yeah, we are also working on a new GUI monitoring and configuring tool for PGPL 2. And that's a big project and hopefully we'll get it done by before 4.3 release. Okay, this brings me to the end of the talk. So thank you very much for sparing your precious time. I'll be happy to take your question here, or you can just reach through email, LinkedIn, Skype, or whatever it suits you. Thank you very much. Okay.